universe. You had given us the holy Sabbath day. You called us into a holy convocation this holy day, this special time. You called us into your house, the gate of heaven, and we've come. You've promised to teach us from your throne, and by your Spirit teach us to help us to understand. We claim the blood of your Son to cover us, to give us life, and we need to hear your words. Inspired by your Holy Spirit, for nothing else is of value. By your word, you created this whole universe. By your word, you formed us. By your word, you called us from our mother's womb. And by your word, you called us into your house. Magnify thyself this day, we pray. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Identifying God's true present truth. You see, wherever there is a true, there is going to be at least one false. And in fact, with every truth of God, it is rare that Satan ever uses only one false to deal with the truth. And with this knowledge, we turn to Proverbs 18:13. He that answereth a matter before he heareth it, it is folly and shame unto him. Seventh-day Adventists worldwide are far too often thinking that whatever doctrine held by the organization, it's truth. But is that God's definition of truth for this time, which is present truth? The last doctrine of faith given into the platform God that came from God came to God's people in 1888. Mm-hmm. And the leadership of the Seventh-day Adventist Church rejected it and is rejecting it even to this very day.
That's true.
Mm-hmm. Even though some claim acceptance, their acceptance is a perversion of what was given in 1888. Mm-hmm. And therefore, by accepting a perversion of it, you're accepting error and not the truth. Mm-hmm. In the 1940s, every doctrine, every major book was altered to fit an acceptable standard of faith in the ecumenical church system of the world. This is not fact. This is not supposition. It is fact and will be proven. In their own words, not in mine. The following statement that I'm going to show on the screen, made in the context of the General Conference forcing a unified baptismal vow church-wide. Leroy Fromm, Movement of Destiny, page 422. The next logical and inevitable step in the implementing of our unified fundamental beliefs involved, in other words, they'd already accomplished it, involved revision of certain standard works so as to eliminate statements that taught and thus perpetrated erroneous views. These productions must therefore be brought into harmony with the now declared faith of the church. Yet God declares in Proverbs 22:28, remove not the ancient landmark which thy fathers have set. Ellen White, Testimonies to the Church, Volume 5, page 199, and also Review and Herald, June 27, 1882, wrote this: "We cannot with impunity break down a single barrier which God has erected to guard his people from Satan's power. Our only safety is in the preserving of the ancient landmarks to the law and to the testimony. If they speak not according to this word, there is how much light?
No light, no truth.
No light. Therefore, if we are going to understand from God's point of view, we must find the platform established by God, not man. God declares in Hosea 4:6, my people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge. Because thou hast rejected knowledge, I will what?
Reject thee.
Now, I don't know about you, but I do not want God rejecting me. There's nothing left if God rejects you. This topic today is a salvational issue. God has made the clear distinction. Reject his knowledge that he wants to give you, and he will reject you.
Amen.
That makes it a salvational issue. Today there is almost a complete ignorance, either willingly or ignorantly, of God's original established present truth for Seventh-day Adventists. This knowledge, when rejected for man's opinions and conjectures, will lead to eternal death and never life. No matter how nice it sounds. God pleads with us today in Jeremiah 6:16, thus saith the Lord, stand ye in the ways and see and ask for what? The old paths. Where is the good way, and walk ye therein, that ye may find rest for your souls, that ye may... And they said what? We will not walk therein. You see, there are two groups of people, God's professed people. Those who will obey and walk in the old paths, and those who refuse, either by choice or ignorance. Jeremiah 6:17, continuing, I have also set watchmen over you, saying, hearken to the sound of the trumpet. But what did they say again? We will not hearken. Again, those two groups will, who will hear and those who will not. Notice what God's prophet declares on those who would marginalize and change the established truth of God. Signs of the Times, November 14, 1895. How is it that you think yourselves at liberty to cancel the decisions of Jehovah and remove the ancient landmarks and substitute in place of the guide boards false waymarks that will lead men to follow a path, the first apostate in place of following Christ? In other words, these are professed Seventh-day Adventists setting up new theologies in the name of Christ, but they're actually following who?
Satan.
And anyone listening to them, supporting them, is not supporting Christ, supporting Satan. Many of them don't realize it. Many of them don't want to know or realize it. Yes, the vast majority of Seventh-day Adventists are not following Christ, but Satan. And as long as there remains a refusal to accept what God has given us as truth, this is a fact. Our topic today, God's true present truth. Therefore, the question must first come up that must be settled into our minds from God is what?
The truth. What is the truth?
What's the first question?
What's present
truth? What is, thank you, brother. What is present God's present truth? Ellen White, the 1888 materials, page 518. The passing of the time in 1844 was a period of great events. opening to our astonished eyes the cleansing of the sanctuary transpiring in heaven, and the decided relation to God's people upon the earth. Also the first, the second messages, angels' messages, and the third, unfolding the banner on which was inscribed the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. One of the landmarks under this message was the temple of God, seen by His truth-loving people in heaven, and the ark containing the law of God. The light of the Sabbath, the fourth commandment, flashed its strong rays on the pathway of the transgressors of God's law. The non-immortality of the wicked is an old landmark. I cannot call to mind nothing more than can come under the head, the old landmarks. I submit to you today, it is an apostasy of grave proportions to think otherwise. But listen to R.F. Cottrell in his presentation, The Sanctuary Doctrine, Asset or Liability, in 2002. In the years immediately following October 22, the traditional sanctuary doctrine was as an important asset for stabilizing the faith of disappointed Adventists. Today, it's equally significant liability and deterrent to faith. Confidence and salvation of biblical, literate Adventists and non-Adventists alike. It was present truth following the great disappointment on October 22, 1844. It is not present truth in the year of our Lord, 2002. This man died an apostate. His theology is taught worldwide in Adventist circles. Directly contradicting the prophet of God. This apostate and his cohort, Lewis Weir, their theology is being taught worldwide to this very day in every circle of Adventism and in most self-supporting Adventist work. To stand and accept the subjects of present truth is valueless if we think we can know present truth outside of the manner in which God has given it to us.
Amen.
Secondly, we must answer the second question. You see, we can identify the different topics of present truth. And we can put definitions and Bible studies and quotations all around them and dress it up and put a bow on it and say this is present truth, and it's totally false.
That's true.
Because unless you establish these topics, which is present truth, from the method in which it was established by God,
yes,
it's not the right foundation.
That's right.
So consequently, we ask the question, how was God's present truth given to God's people? Is that not the next question?
Yes.
Amen. Notebook Leaflets, Volume 2, page 157. The standard bearers who have fallen in death are to speak through the reprinting of their writings. And then the prophet of God makes a three-word declaration, and I would encourage anyone to study when she says this. I am instructed. Now, when the prophet of God says, I'm instructed, who can we presume by faith is instructing her?
God
the Father, right from the throne, by the authority of the throne of God. That thus their voices are to be heard. They are to bear their testimony as to what constitutes truth for this time. Now the phrase for truth for this time is another way of saying present truth. To further establish this fact, we go to Special Testimony Series B, number 7, page 58. We may be strengthened and confirmed in the past experience that holds us to the essential points of truth which have made us what we are, Seventh-day Adventists. The past 50 years. Now note, this was written in 1905. This is significant. The past 50 years have not dimmed one jot or principle of our faith, as we have received the great and wonderful evidences that made certain to us in 1844 and after the passing of time. Not a word is to be changed or denied. That which the Spirit, Holy Spirit, testified as truth after the passing of time, in our great disappointment, is the solid foundation of truth. Pillars of truth were revealed, and we accepted the foundation principles that have made us what we are as Seventh-day Adventists.
Amen.
Now this is extremely important. We must. Now this is me talking. We must, if rightly profess the name Seventh-day Adventist, to be standing on the historical platform God established as present truth and nothing else. Anything less is apostasy and not following God, but following Satan's path and authority. We must also obey God in our lives and now allow nothing to lessen the importance of these truths. They have to come first. Now, if you think that I'm all crazy, listen to this. Special Testimony, Series B, number 2, page 51. These are the original writings that were made testimonies to ministers when they made the changes in testimonies to ministers. It's not the originals here. The principles of truth that God has revealed to us are our true foundation.
Always true foundation.
Thank you. Our only. So in other words, there can't be another one, right?
Amen.
Okay. They have made us what we are. The lapse of time has what? Not lessened their value. In other words, when someone tells you, oh, that was good enough for them back there, but we've progressed.
No. God forbid.
What does that tell you? When the prophet says that they haven't lessened in their value, and someone tells you that they have lessened in their value, who are you going to listen to?
God.
Well, you better be listening to God if you're going
to
go to heaven. It is the constant effort of the enemy to remove these truths from their setting. Now, you see, there's a concept here that we need to kind of get into our heads. I've been going over it for 4 years, but I'm going to reiterate here for just a few seconds. When the prophet of God says these truths in their proper place, we need to understand. These truths are placed in the foundation in an orderly fashion for a reason. And when we start juggling them around, they start losing their importance. There's a reason why the first angel's message is the first step to the platform of truth. There's a reason why the second angel's message is the second step to the platform of truth. There's a reason why the third angel's message is the third and last step. If you jump from not being in present truth directly to the third step, you have missed an awful lot of present truth that you will never get unless you go back.
Amen.
to the first step.
That's right.
Oh, you'll get a little bit, but it won't be in the right context. And it won't be on the right platform. He will bring so much. This Satan will bring so much to remove the truths from their settings and to put in their place spurious theories. He will bring everything that he possibly can carry out his deceptive designs. But the Lord, oh praise the Lord, the Lord will raise up men with keen perception who will give these truths in their proper place in the plan of God. Exactly what God warned us not to allow has been done nigh on 100 years.
True.
Out in the lobby, we have a pamphlet called The Godhead versus the Trinity. In there, it documents how that doctrine has systematically been changed from 1916, less than 6 months after Ellen White died, to today. Where now, if you would hold to the statement of beliefs of the Seventh-day Adventist Organized General Conference, you will be believing Catholic theology. Not God's truth. I mean, it's like this. If you sit in a room with a 1,000-candle-watt light bulb and you're given a book to read, how easy is it to read it?
Very easy.
Now, every 10 minutes, you turn it down 100 watts. By the time you get to 100 watts instead of 1,000 watts, can you still read? You can read because your eyes do what? They adjust to the darkening of the room. Then you go to a 50-watt light bulb. Can you still read? Yes, but it'll be even more difficult. That's where the apostasy is. Less than a 50-watt light bulb. But you take now and suddenly turn on 1,000 watts. What happens to your eyeballs? You can't see a thing. Because why?
Too bright.
It's too bright. But it wasn't too bright when you started out. You were reading just fine. Most Seventh-day Adventists are in such darkness they don't realize how dark it is until they get face-to-face with present truth the way God set it up, and they go, whoa, wait a minute, you're blinding me. This can't be truth. I think some of us got the point. Testimonies to the Church, Volume 6, page 61. Let nothing lessen the force of the truth for this time. The present truth is to be our burden. Now, when I first gave this quotation, I asked those who are in English, because I speak English but don't know how to do all the grammar stuff. I have to keep asking the people who know, because I'm very illiterate in some aspects. So I asked them. The first sentence is, let nothing lessen the force of the truth for this time. And then the prophet of God says, the present truth. And I was told, and I believe it's true,
praise the Lord,
that the present truth refers to the previous sentence that says the truth for this time.
That's right.
Amen.
So we know for a fact when she says that the writings of the pioneers is what constitutes truth for this time, and then here she said truth for this time is the present truth, which is to be our burden, we better start reading what she tells us to read.
Amen.
Don't claim to be an Adventist and not reading what she told you to read. Because you don't even know what Adventist is.
That's true.
You know what apostate Adventism is. Because that's all you know. I'm a third generation Seventh-day Adventist. I was raised in apostasy.
Wow. my God.
Born into it. And when the light comes on, it blinds you sometimes. You have to stand back and say, okay, Lord, a little bit at a time. Bring the light up a little bit at a time, because I can't handle all of it at once. And as long as you stay surrendered, He will bring the light up in Amen. Full light.
Praise
full,
the Lord.
Full light.
Amen.
He will not let you perish if you are staying surrendered. But if you constipate your spirituality to the point, I don't want to do, then you're walking without Christ,
no
matter what you profess. The third angel's message must do its work of separating from the churches a people. Are you hearing what's going on here? She says, the third angel's message must do its work of separating from the churches a people who will take their stand on the platform of eternal truth. In other words, you're supposed to come out so you can stand on the platform.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Woo.
Yes.
Now get this. Our message is a life and death message.
Yes.
And we must let it appear as it is. The great power of God. We are to present it in all its telling force. Then the Lord will make it what?
Effectual.
Effectual. With these admonitions, we must recognize what God has done in our past history and guard it as sacred truth and our foundation. Now, I'm going to stop here right again. When I'm referring to the foundation of truth, do not box me in to how some of these radical individuals who are unbalanced, who promote the writings of the pioneers, to make you think that the foundation is the whole. The foundation, the pioneer writings, and the writings of Ellen White is the foundation with the Bible. When you are standing on the foundation, now you can build and become a living stone.
That's right.
There are concepts that the Lord, by His Holy Spirit, are bringing into our minds that were never brought in to the pioneers. But not one thing disagrees with what they said. It just brings it even brighter and brighter and brighter. I've had people come and on Facebook, on messages, on emails, and a few on the phone, and they're saying, Pastor, I don't know where you're getting this stuff, but this is deep. I've had to listen to the sermon 3 times, and it's just too deep.
My God.
One young man, he's going to be here in 2 weeks. Week and a half, to be honest with you. And he said, Pastor, why doesn't other preachers preach like you? I said, well, I don't know. I'm just saying, praise the Lord. It's not me. Don't glorify me, because I don't know anything. I have to keep telling people, don't glorify me. I'm nobody. But just praise the Lord that you're starting to hear something that you need for your soul. You see, it's an important principle. Unless we understand this principle, listen to this. Bible Echo. Never put anyplace else. August 29, 1898. Solomon knew that God had chosen Israel and made them the depository of the truth and the sacred faith. God had erected a wise barrier between them and the rest of the world. And only by jealously guarding the ancient landmarks could they preserve their high and distinct character.
Praise the Lord.
Only.
The only thing. Only by jealously guarding. Now, there's a difference between standing guard and being jealously guarding. Is there not?
Yes.
When you are jealously guarding, what is the first thing on your mind? Where is the attack coming from? And being on the lookout for any possible thing coming against you. Guard it.
Protect.
We must be like Solomon, recognizing the barriers God has given us, the Seventh-day Adventists. God inspired men through comprehensive Bible study together. Now, this is something that I've said before, and I'm going to say it again. Satan has done a really good work on Adventists.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
When you had Bates and James White and Edson and others sitting around the table literally almost all night with Ellen White. Ellen White sitting there totally not understanding a thing. And these men are going and hashing the scriptures. And they come to significant points. And they get to these points. And they hammer them out. And when they didn't understand it, then Ellen White went into vision, explained it, and went completely blank after that. That's how we were established. Mm-hmm. But do we as Seventh-day Adventists today even want to think about driving 100 miles to do a Bible study with a father brother? And so let's sit down and really hash out something of historical platform of truth. No. I mean, they drove sometimes 100 miles with horse and buggy, spent 3 weeks together studying, and then went back to their businesses.
Mm-hmm.
But ain't nobody, no ministers want to sit down with each other. They've got their thing of raising funds and doing this and doing that, but they're never going to sit down and study with you. How are we going to be like the pioneers if we don't even want to study with each other?
Amen on that.
Amen.
How can we be a remnant if we're not even like the first part of the generation?
Yes.
God gave, besides these men, Ellen White as the messenger and prophet of God for correction, for confirmation of the truths learned. You see, when Ellen White wrote on subjects of present truth, such as in great controversy, she gave only comprehensive, condensed overviews of the subjects. Never anywhere in her writings is there an exhaustive understanding of any of the pillars of our faith. Not one. I will give $1,000 to anyone who shows me an original writing of Ellen White that discusses any of the foundation pillars of the faith in its exhaustive form. There isn't. Why? Because the pioneers were given that chance. A.T. Jones, E.J. Wagner, prolific writers.
Mm-hmm.
Jay and Andrews, prolific writer. Loughborough, prolific writer. The first draft of Righteousness by Faith was given by Daniel T. Bordeaux in 1864. Sanctification or Living Holiness. Every single minister until 1940 had to have it in his library and have studied it. And now Seventh-day Adventists don't even know the book exists unless they come to our website.
My God.
It's because of this fact. We must never think to make the writings of Ellen White the definition of our faith. It was not her role. Anyone doing so cannot stand on the platform God gave to His called people, Seventh-day Adventists. This does not demean the role of the prophet. It confirms it. Let me put it to you this way. If I'm building a building, and God gave me the insight how to be a contractor. Now, I know for a fact, most contractors don't know how to do everything to build a house. They're a contractor that does what? Contracts out the specialty things that needs to be done. Now, I may understand all the principles of how to build a house. But if I don't have a plumber and electrician who is very skilled in those areas, do the plumbing and electrical work, I'm going to have a sad thing for a house. Now, it may be the best plan and may look the greatest. And I may know how and where I want all the electrical outlets to be and how I want everything to be set up. But if I don't have an electrician put it together, it's going to be a mess. I built a print shop up in Tennessee. Designed the whole thing. Exactly how I wanted it. And I called a carpenter, a professional carpenter, to frame it. He took my plan and said, now if you make this adjustment, it will be strong enough to withstand tornadoes. I said, okay, do it. I didn't have to ask him why. That makes sense. Why? Because I'm going to trust his expertise. The same way it is. When God told Ellen White that Uriah Smith was to write a book, did Ellen White tell him what to put in the book?
No.
God was going to do that. When Ellen White asked Haskell to write books, did Ellen White tell him what to put in the book? No, because God was going to do that. You get the point. It is because of the rejection of the writings of the pioneer men, God chose to write down in detail the platform of present truth that we have suffered as a people. For the remaining of our time today, we are going to connect not anyone's opinion, but present truth fact as to the importance of the historical platform established by the pioneers. Once we know and stand on the established platform, we then, by God, will be given greater understanding of His truth and application for today. But anyone who professes the truths of Adventism, who has not established their own in their own mind from the perspective of God's design, it is not standing on God's platform, but a false, and therefore must unlearn errors to relearn according to God's way and not man's.
Right.
The three angels' messages are steps onto our platform of faith. Yet listen to God's prophet. Review and Herald, December 11th, page, December 11th, 1888. Did I miss that one? Yep, I did. I missed that slide. I'll put it in later. This is what it says. It is not in the order of God that light has been kept from our people. The very present truth which they needed for this time. Not all our ministers are giving the third angel's message. Really understand what constitutes that message. The third angel's message comprehends more than many supposed, written in 1888. This clearly shows that if not all understand then, how much fewer understand it today. With this in mind, I submit to you today, when the highest, from the highest leadership to the ministers being trained today, nearly all either rejecting or ignoring the historic platform of present truth.
That's right.
Here are the 3 points. Point number one. The prophetic interpretation of Daniel 2 and Revelation 13. Point number three. The proper God-given understanding of prophecy and the three angels' messages. Remember, I put prophecy and the three angels' messages. We're going to understand that there is a difference. And we're going to understand that in just a minute. Third point, which we are not going to cover today, but in the next sermon. The sanctuary message and our duty and its connection and application. Since 1980, this has never even been discussed in mainline churches. And most self-supporting, sadly. Quickly, we will cover these, not exhaust them, but we will bring them out. Point number one. The prophetic interpretation of Daniel 2 and Revelation 13. Ellen White wrote not a single line declaring what the stone of Daniel 2 represents. In fact, for that very reason, this is why to this day the shepherd's rod occultists, and I use that word directly for a reason, are harassing God's people. Why did God not have Ellen White write anything on the stone of Daniel 2? There is not one word in published and unpublished writings of Ellen White that deal with the stone of Daniel 2. Not one. And this is why Shepherd's Rod feels they have the authority to tell you what the stone means, because Ellen White didn't say anything. Because when the mainline churches rejected the pioneer writings, they had nothing to stand on to defend their faith. It is because throughout the establishment of the platform of truth from 1855 to 1905, which is the area of time which she said established the truth, the present truth, she said for the last 50 years. She wrote that in 1905, so therefore from 1905 backwards 50 years, these books are primary for us to look at, unless there is a direct quotation from the prophet of God telling us to look at others, and those are synopsis of present truth, not synopsis, but the seer of Patmos, the story of Daniel, and Cross in its Shadow by S. N. Haskell, which Ellen White asked him to write after 1905. We need to understand. We need to know our history and live our history. Uriah Smith, S.N. Haskell, A.T. Jones, Percy McGann, Josiah Litch, and many others all stood in unison of what the stone represented. Ellen White didn't need to say anything. In regards to Revelation 13, the establishment of the United States as the two-horned beast, again, when rejecting the writings of the pioneers, we fail to clearly, distinctly present the truth as God would have it done. It has made it difficult for Native American Indians to accept Adventism. When the evangelism of the General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists for over 100 years has literally demeaned and degraded their existence, and to declare them as being uncivilized. You see, when in fact their form of government, even though the white man from Europe considered them uncivilized, the American Indian did have very much laws and governments formed in this United States.
Yes, they did.
And when you say that they came into an area and the United States came out of the land because it was out of an area uncivilized, you are demeaning a whole race of people. Yes. And God will not do that.
No, He won't.
God gave us clear distinct methods of prophetic interpretation, and that never was to be offensive or degrading to any people on the earth, for God is no respecter of persons, Acts 10, 34 and 35.
Amen.
Note what was established as present truth. Now I'm going to give you from the pioneer writings themselves exactly how, in a nutshell, because I can't do it in 1 hour. I'm telling you, I'm sorry. You can't do it. Mm. Uriah Smith himself wrote a 300-page book on establishment of the United States as the two-horned beast of Revelation 13.
Yes, he did.
Called The Marvel of the Nations.
That's right. Good book.
Now, how can you understand how the United States establishes the two-horned beast if you haven't even read or even glanced through or even know that the book exists? Praise the Lord, in 2016 it's going to be available again, because I have several copies of it. Original copies. By God's grace. It's only by God's grace. And those that have been helping me with the editing of our publication, they have said, man, this is powerful. Jane Andrews, 1855. The three angels' message, the three angels of Revelation 14, page 88. As the four powers of the eastern continent were not to be succeeded by a fifth, we understand that the power represented by the beast with two horns, which arises in the last days of the fourth beast, must be located in where?
America.
America. Now notice. Let's go on. This lamb-like power, the noblest of the last offspring of time, must also in its draconian character prove itself the basest. As we have said, the two-horned beast does not arise by overthrowing its predecessor. This statement coming true more and more today. If you don't think the United States government is becoming basest and baser and more evil and evil and evil, you are so spiritually dead, I don't even know why you're here. But praise the Lord, He brought you here. If you don't understand that the United States is an evil place.
Yes, sir. We know that.
Yes, yes.
We know that.
And guess what? It's going to get worse.
Yes, we know that.
Notice as he continues. And it is worthy of notice that the ten kingdoms of the fourth empire were all complete long before discovery of America. And the war of revolution. Now he gets particular. Now he's dealing with the establishment. And the war of the revolution was not for the purpose of overthrowing one of the ten kingdoms of the fourth empire, but it was what? To maintain the rights of the American people. Uriah Smith also clearly, distinctly sets forth present truth in its correct context by stating this. And Advent Review and Sabbath Herald, March 12, 1857. Note this. This is at the very beginning of the establishment of our platform of faith. No government of any note has been formed in Europe which was not included in some one of the ten horns at the time of their rise. But it is not said that one of these horns should by some strange metamorphosis become another distinct beast. Therefore, we cannot look to the... This is how we were supposed to establish the United States as the two-horned beast. Listen to this. We cannot look to the territory of any of the ten horns for the two-horned beast in question. In other words, We are excluded from the continent of Europe. It cannot be there.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Amen. Yes.
Wow.
It is in the understanding of Revelation 13 properly from the historic present truth perspective that there is confidence and trust in the waymarks God has given. This is, it's a powerful thing.
Yes, yes.
I did a whole sermon on this, and I'm just going to encapsulate just one little more. There's quotations to prove it. You see, Daniel 2 and Daniel 7 cover a part of the world that was called the sea.
Yes.
And it was what kind of sea? Was it a calm sea?
No, raging sea.
It was a raging sea. These beasts came out of the sea. And this is representative not of the entire world as we teach today, but only of the European and Middle East area where the four beasts came out of. It doesn't include China, it doesn't include India, it doesn't include Russia area, it doesn't include South America, North America, it only covers the European, Euro-Asian aspect of the world. That's the only part, that's the sea. In prophetic prophecy, not all peoples, just the peoples that God was dealing with at that time. The earth is everything else. That is why we have to understand it from the right perspective. Because even some could argue that there was another government somewhere in the world that was not part of Daniel 2 and Daniel 7, that could be the two-horned beast. And so not only do we look at these quotations, but more to reestablish without doubt that this is the government of the two-horned beast. Timing, there's timing, there's the form of government. There's only been one government in the 6,000 years of history that was formed like the United States. There's so many different things, but we don't have to demean anybody to do it. Point number two. Understanding of prophecy in the three angels' messages. With a quick overview. The first angel's message has with it a prophetic message. This is something that some of you may have never heard before. That's okay. Just sit back and listen. Contemplate, meditate, and understand what the truth really is. The first angel's message has with it a prophetic message. What prophetic message comes with the first angel's message? Church, my members who know what the answer is. What is the prophetic message that comes with the first angel's message?
1844.
Excuse me?
1844.
Daniel 8:14. The prophetic message that the Day of Atonement is going to begin on 1844, October 22. That's the prophetic message that comes with hand and foot with the first angel's message.
Yes, sir.
Now, the third angel's message has a prophetic message with it. And here is where the majority fall off the platform of truth. You see, since 1942, there has been a deception against Seventh-day Adventism so great that almost every professed Seventh-day Adventist is now believing lies and not present truth. It is in this third angel's message, Revelation 10, verse 11, the angel says to John, "Thou must prophesy again before peoples, nations, tongues, and kings." But the problem is we don't know what the original prophecy that we are supposed to prophesy. This prophetic aspect of the third angel's message is not the mark of the beast or have anything to do with the papacy. It does, although, have a great deal to do with the close of the great antipical day of atonement in the heavenly sanctuary. The first angel's message brings the prophetic message of the day of atonement is to begin. It is to begin. It is to begin. Wake up! It's time to afflict your soul. Everybody thought it was the second coming. Now, William Miller, if he would have understood the first angel's message correctly, and he started preaching, the day of atonement's going to come, the day of atonement's going to come, how many would have really listened?
Not one.
Nobody. So God put his thumb over the true understanding of Daniel 8:14 so that the message could go out with a loud cry. Yeah. Yes, and then it was told what the real message of 1844 was all about. And they says, oh Lord, have mercy on us. Thank you. But God didn't stop there when he gave the message to Daniel. He gave the opening. And then he gives the closing.
Yes, sir.
And for nigh 100 years, we have as a people said, I don't want that message. I'm going to change it. It has altogether to do with the closing of the Day of Atonement. Daniel 12, verse 1, and at that time, Michael shall stand up, the great prince. And boy, when he makes that declaration, you better be ready. Even though, again, Ellen White is silent, there are a host of pioneers all united in the interpretation of Daniel 11, 45, and 12, 1.
Yes, there are.
Uriah Smith, Stephen Haskell, A.T. Jones are all in unison. More than 500 pages written in their own hand. And praise the Lord, we have Tim here, who has compressed it all down into a book that we've called The King of the North Rises Again. But over 40 quotations out of those books. And he read all 500 pages of them, trust me, and a whole lot more. Over 1,000 pages he read on this subject. Trust me, it's irrefutable. When we have 2 and 3 pioneers all agreeing on the establishment of present truth, God says it's established by his authority. Deuteronomy 19:15, out of the mouth, at the mouth of 2 witnesses, or the mouth of 3 witnesses, the matter is what?
Established.
Established. Note what God's prophet Ellen White wrote. Now, I'm telling you what. Can I make a confession here? Is it okay?
Sure.
When I was first given the insight of the importance of the pioneers, there's one man I refused to listen to. That is Uriah Smith. And the reason for it was twofold. I knew for a fact that he had by his name placed by his name the accusation of murder. Because he was instrumental in the early death of James White. I also know for a fact that he was very vehement against the 1888 message.
Yes, he was.
And so when I was doing some studying and I came across this quotation we're going to read, I said, Lord, help me. I need to understand, because I'm telling you what, I have a real big problem with a man who you're saying is in here that I'm supposed to listen to. And you're going to have to help me to put the whole thing together again. Because I read Daniel Revelation, the one produced by the General Conference, the 1944 edition.
Yes.
And that is so confusing to me. I said, there is no possible way it is truth, because it completely contradicts everybody else of your pioneers. And so there's got to be a problem. There's got to be a solution here. And I prayed about it.
Praise the Lord.
I said, Lord, you got to show me. Because you're not a God of confusion.
Amen.
And I asked Tim to help me with the research, because I was on, this was a massive sermon that was being done, and I needed help. And with my dyslexia and everything else, I was not able to concept this thing like it needed to be. I said, Tim, I need you to do some research for me. Help me out here. And he found the quotation. And I've used it with people who assassinate me because I quote Uriah Smith. Mm-hmm. Ellen White, around 1892, sent a letter directly to Uriah Smith, acknowledging his full confession of the sins of his past and his acceptance of Jones and Wagner as the authority of the 1888 message.
Mm. Thank God.
Now note this. This is the quotation. Manuscript Releases, Volume 1, page 61. Those who are preparing to enter ministry, who desire to become successful students of the prophecies, will find Daniel and the Revelation an invaluable help. They need to understand this book. It speaks of past, present, and future, laying out the past so plainly none can err therein. Those who will study diligently this book will have to relish,
have no relish
for the cheap sentiments presented by those who desire to have a burning desire to get out something new and strange to present to the flock of God. The rebuke of God is upon all such teachers. They need one to teach them what is meant by godliness and truth.
Amen. Amen.
The great essential questions God would have presented to the people are found in Daniel and the Revelation. There is found solid eternal truth for this time. Everyone, now she goes from the ministers to now she says everyone. So if you want salvation and you want to understand prophecy in its correct form, she's saying you got to go to this book. Everyone needs light and information it contains. Concluding two pages later, on page 63, the interest in Daniel and the Revelation is to continue as long as probationary time shall last.
Wow.
God has used the author of this book as a channel through which to communicate light to direct the minds to truth. Shall we not appreciate this light, which points us to the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, our King? Now note this. So now I've got a problem. You see my problem?
Yes.
I'm reading a book that clearly contradicts everything else everybody else wrote. Including S. N. Haskell, who Ellen White also asked to write the books on Daniel and Revelation, but the two did not connect together. They were complete opposite.
How can that be?
Now, how can that be? Now, is the prophet wrong, or is she right?
She's right.
She's correct. Now, the Paul Harvey rest in story. in 1944, a Jesuit by the name of Leroy Fong,
the
head of the E.G. White Estate, under his authority, made over 10,000 changes to the original manuscript of Uriah Smith.
Jesuit.
And that was just in the portion of Daniel. Theology of Daniel 8, Daniel 7, Daniel 9, Daniel 10, 11, and 12 was completely rewritten.
My God.
And we have verified every bit of it. And that is why when God gave me the original 1897 edition, we repented. The original.
Thank you,
Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Yes.
Amen. Amen.
You see, the General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists knew that Essen Haskell and his books would be put into insignificance because of the pride of Uriah Smith. He would not print them in the General Conference publishing house. And Essen Haskell had to have his self-published. And because they were self-published, they didn't have the quote, end quote, impronto of the publishing house of the General Conference. And so most people would ignore them and would go into oblivion. And then with the supposed apostasy of A.T. Jones, which did not happen, and I have proof of that too.
I know that. I knew that.
His books would be discredited. So the only book they had to deal with was Uriah Smith's book of Daniel and Revelation.
Yes.
Do you understand?
Now,
God gave us more than 100 years ago exactly when the close of probation would happen. Yet in 1942, the theological department of Andrews University accepted the teachings of Lewis Weir and R.F. Cottrell with the help of Leroy Fromm and destroyed the prophetic interpretation given by God. John Groesbaugh stood in this pulpit and clearly let everybody know that he was in the seminary when they were driving it down everybody's throat of Lewis Weir's theology against the pioneers. And to this day, worldwide, every single seminary of the General Conference is teaching this error. The close of probation has nothing to do with Sunday legislation. Nothing to do with it. And yet it is being taught as truth. Get this and understand it correctly. Unless you are on the historic platform, you are going to hell.
Let's copy that.
The Sunday legislation, which is part of the third angel's message, but it's not the close of probation. When you say the close of probation is the Sunday law, you completely do away with all the prophet's admonition to the church to go house to house, Bible studies on the Sabbath after the institution of Sunday laws. House to house, from city to city, being thrown out of the cities as you're going to the mountains. You completely do away with the Holy Spirit and his admonitions to the prophet. It has nothing to do with the papacy. It has nothing to do with apostate Protestantism. But it has everything to do with the movements of Turkey and the Sunni Muslim religion.
That's true.
No matter how long you have attended a Seventh-day Adventist church, no matter what you've learned in the seminary or anywhere else, having met Your membership in good and regular standing means nothing in the context of present truth. God is asking us today, are you willing to stand on present truth? The platform he established? Or you want to stay on man's? You see, God's is solid. It cannot be shaken. Cannot. And we're heading into a violent storm that if you are not standing on a solid foundation, you will be lost. Mm. And man's interpretation is sand and untempered mortar.
That's right.
Do a word study in the spirit of prophecy on untempered mortar. You'd be shocked. Do not lessen the power of the Holy Spirit by rejecting how God has laid his foundation. Don't you tell me that Uriah Smith wasn't inspired by God to write Daniel and Revelation. He was. When the prophet of God says, Haskell, you write, you've got an insight even different than Uriah Smith, but you're the same, but I want you to both write it because you come from a different perspective. And so it's a beautiful thing when my wife and I spent almost 9 months in our study at home. We would read Daniel and Revelation, the original edition, and we read Story of Daniel and Seer of Patmos by Haskell, and one would bring this out this way, and one would bring out, but guess what? They always were united.
Amen.
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 Matter of two witnesses?
Mm-hmm.
Matters what?
Established.
Yes.
We must be willing to be taught of God, not of man.
Right.
To have his Holy Spirit burn out the errors brought in by apostasy. To burn out self and self-conceived ideas and rely solely on God's truth and nothing but his truth. To live by the Spirit must have the purging fire of the Holy Spirit do his work in us. In me and in you. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
It is difficult with what's going on in our lives, with the hectic aspects of responsibilities. But we need to say, Lord, help organize my life so no matter what, I'm going to take time to study what he's given me to study. Is the National Sunday Law important? End time events? Sure it is. It's not the close of probation.
Mm-hmm.
But God has given us waymarks to understand where we are. And he's shouting, time is short. My son is going to step out from before my throne. And it's going to happen really soon. I'm sending angels from my throne to help guide you. I even brought you here today. Are you willing to listen? Let us kneel before his throne and commit ourselves to him. Loving, merciful, and gracious Father in heaven. As James White wrote, as Haskell confirmed, there are not two groups of Seventh-day Adventists in the world, there are three. There are those who are spiritually dead. They're called SDA, spiritually dead Adventists. In the camp of Sardis. No matter what is said, Lord, your spirit is, they're calling lightness dark and dark lightness. And then you have the spiritually satisfied Adventist in Laodicea. I've got all I need to be saved. I'm even conservative. I know how to eat. I know how to dress. I don't need any more. But I thank you, Lord, for providing one more group. The spiritually hungry Seventh-day Adventists. And in this group of Philadelphia, there is not one single person satisfied with where they're at. They mourn over the sin of their past. They strive to bring every morsel of truth into their life and assimilate it because they are wanting to do nothing but cooperate with their high priest. To plead as the brother and sister in 1850 wrote, our prayer together is just, Lord, please retain our names on your breastplate before your Father, our Father. Let nothing in our lives make it that you have to take our names off that breastplate. Lord, we kneel here before your throne. Your truth has been presented. May by your Holy Spirit it be brought into the life, assimilated, that we, without reservation, reorganize our lives so that we may study and know the faith that you have given to us. Unreservedly surrendered to your authority. We pray in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.